Welcome back to the Community Review on Hot 92.3. I'm host Steffa Salinas, your host. Well, in this segment, I've saved my three favorite things from 2011. The first thing was when I had Robert Mazur on. He wrote a book called The Infiltrator. He was an undercover agent who helped bring down Pablo Escobar and one of the largest banks in the world. You won't believe what he told me is going on right now, actually with a couple of my banks. I couldn't believe it. And you can bet I'm going to follow this story right into 2012 to keep you up to date on the dirty tricks these banks continue to get away with right in the United States of America. Together, we can fight it as long as we're armed with information. And thanks to Robert Mazur, I'm sure we will be. Let's hear what Robert had to say.
What we decided to do in order to really attack and get credible evidence about those involved at the highest levels of laundering money for the Medellin cartel was to put together an undercover operation that would infiltrate it. And they were very, very active in what they explained to me was the marketing of flight capital. And I learned from them that flight capital includes drug money, but it also includes money from other illegal sources. It could be money from tax evasion or the evasion of customs duties. It could be money from the pilfering of treasuries from third world countries. It could be monies from arms dealing, terrorist activity. All of it has the same need, and that is being handled secretly so that other governments cannot identify the true source of the funds. There is a skill set that the international banking community offers to people who possess that type of money that enables them to transform its appearance to a legal source. But I learned from best of the best at BCCI, during the course that I worked with them undercover. I recorded hundreds of meetings behind closed boardroom doors with them. I came to learn that they learned this process as they went through careers in other banks. They worked at other banks, including Bank of America, the Royal Bank of Canada, many other banks. After they were convicted, I had the opportunity to be part of a debriefing team. And their bottom line was, you know, why are you guys picking on us? We're not doing anything that other people in the international banking community aren't doing.
Now, Robert, you wrote an interesting paper recently. Actually, it was in September of 2011, talking about some illegal activity with banks right here in the U.S.
And that paper details the involvement of about 10 or 12 international banks in the active solicitation of this money and the laundering of it for criminal organizations. One of the examples would be the Wachovia Bank scandal of last year. Wachovia entered into what's called a deferred prosecution. I call it a legal hand slap with the Department of Justice. They admitted criminal offense in connection with their solicitation of $400 billion in U.S. dollar deposits for account holders in Mexico during the years 2004 through 2007. And among the services they provided was the physical transportation of roughly $14 billion in bulk currency. That bulk currency, in my view, was earned for the most part on the streets of the major cities of the United States and smuggled across our border south into Mexico, where it was then given to houses of exchange called casas de cambio in Mexico and given an appearance of having been received for legitimate business. I used to be in the money laundering business. Even if it was all in 20s, the $14 billion brought back into the U.S. by Wachovia would have weighed 725 tons. I mean, who in the world did they think they were getting 725 tons of cash from in Mexico? That represents one-third of the gross national product for Mexico. And there is an active involvement by a considerable number of international banks, and I address that in my paper, but I think the BCCI bankers were being truthful when they claimed that what they were doing was nothing different than what many other international banks did.
So basically they're saying, why are you picking on us when everybody's doing it?
That's right.
Jeez. Yeah. Now, Wachovia got a hand slap for this?
Yeah, Wachovia's huge penalty for this was no one was individually criminally prosecuted. The bank admitted criminal wrongdoing. The bank paid a whopping $160 million fine. That represented 2% of Wachovia's profits that year. And I can guarantee you the amount of profit they made off of collecting that $400 billion in deposits for account holders was far, far greater than the $160 million fine that they wound up paying.
So you can see this problem isn't going away. And I can assure you, Robert Mazur will be back with more information because I'm not letting this one go. We'll be updating you all through 2012 on just what exactly our local banks are really up to. Now let's go to some good stuff. One of the things that I love the most about my job, when I can make opportunities happen for other people or groups. John Burroughs High School was the recipient of one of my connections. They went to Beijing, China, courtesy of the Community Review this past summer. Here's a little recap of the event in Beijing. Meeting in Beijing, a grand gathering of young men and women from all over the world. It's happening August 13th through the 21st. The whole purpose to bring peace, friendship, hope, and talk about the future. They're going to have a welcoming ceremony. They're going to do sightseeing to the Palace Museum, the Great Wall, the Summer Palace, all kinds of different places, taste traditional Chinese culture and the food. They'll visit the Olympic venues, the Bird's Nest, the Water Cube. And then we're talking about a cultural exchange. Each group that's coming is going to perform. There's going to be an evening gala. They're going to do a huge television performance. So they wanted amazing young people from around the world. So, of course, the amazing young people that I sent them, John Burroughs High School, and they are in the house with us today. Grace, Liz, Nevada, Leo, and Nate, good morning.
Good morning.
I am so, so proud of you guys because it wasn't just a matter of me saying, you know, oh, yes, send them. You guys had to submit some tape, and then they've reviewed hundreds of groups from around the world. And they handpicked the groups that they wanted, and you guys were one of them, and they love you. And I am so proud of you, and I'm sure your parents are just ecstatic.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
So let's talk a little bit about what you guys do, in case somebody's just tuning in and they didn't hear the interview about the incredible thing at the Starlight Bowl. So they're like, you know, John Burroughs, what do? Are they athletes? What are they?
Well, yeah, we're a show choir, so like we sing and dance with like a bunch of genres of music.
So kind of like Glee.
Yeah.
I mean, if somebody was to try to get a picture in their mind, okay, show choir. When people hear choir, they think church.
Yeah.
But we're not talking church. We're talking more like Glee.
Yep, like a more upbeat like group.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Very cool. So you're going to go over there and sing. And do you guys dance too?
Yes.
Yeah. So how excited were you when somebody called and said, hey, you want to go to China?
Oh, man. That's very exciting.
Yeah.
Couldn't believe it.
Okay, so how about a little taste of something? Can you guys, like, do something off the top of your head, a little acapella?
No.
I'll give you a couple seconds to think about something you guys could do together.
What do you guys want to do?
One, two, three, four.
Do you ever feel so paper thin, like a house of cards, one blow from caving in? If you only knew what the future holds, after a hurricane comes a rainbow.
Maybe the reason why all your doors are closed, so you could open one that leads you to the perfect road.
And like a lightning bolt, your heart will blow, cause there's a spark in you. You just gotta ignite the light and let it shine. Just on the night, like the 4th of July. Cause baby, you're a firework. Come on, show 'em what you're worth.
Make 'em go up.
You know you're gonna go high.
As you shoot across the sky.
You gotta shoot for the sky.
Now you see why John Burroughs High School was chosen to represent in China. And I am so proud of the Community Review for being the ones that sent them there. We're going to wrap this year up with a story that still, to me, takes the number one spot out of all the stories and investigations and interviews that we did all year long. It was an interview with a mother who came forward after years to tell her story of molestation with her daughters right here in the studio. The reason she did it, for all the young women and women out there who might be holding that same secret, to give them the courage to come forward. After this show aired, we got over 80 requests for information on help for situations just like this. Tell us again, how do you feel now that you have told the world, you told your family, everyone knows finally the secret that you had to hold in all of those years? What has that done for you?
I can stand in the top of a mountain and say I was molested and it wasn't my fault. I didn't want to do it.
Mm-hmm. But they brainwash you. I was a hostage for so many years. Because you are a hostage. You are right. You these men have so much control over you. Mm-hmm. And until the day that you can say it and say it loud. And for all of you women out there that have been molested by their father, their uncles, their brothers, their friends, a family friend, because it isn't the boogeyman that comes and molests, it is the one in the family, somebody right. that knows them. Mm-hmm. So my thing was that when I was caged into this little cage where I was miserable for 60-some years, I was watching my kids. My kids were not allowed to spend the night in anybody's house because I was so afraid that something would happen to them and they wouldn't tell me. And that's why now I beg of all the women out there, tell, because those men don't stop. We have to stop them because the family is the one that they protect these child molesters. And even if they're 60 years old, 100 years old, if they're a child molester, they're going to continue molesting people, kids.
Right.
And if I can save one little girl, I did my job.
Well, you've done an amazing job this afternoon.
Well, I just hope that my story, which is sad because I can't believe it. I can't believe that I'm not crying because I cry every time I think of it. I was crying on the way home, on the way over here. But you know, something that we have to talk. We have yes. to, unless these men know that they're not going to be covered up, because this man just passed away. And I'm hoping that one day I can forgive him. I hope, for my own sake. Mm-hmm. But as of now, no, I can't. I still have a lot of anger, but see what happens.
Well, I hope that you can, because the day that you can forgive him is the day that it will no longer be with you. As long as you don't forgive, it's going to stay with yes. you. And so you have to release it and let it go.
One thing that helped me a lot, Anne Marie gave me a book, and mm-hmm. Ancestor Survivor, mm-hmm. and I've been reading it. Every story is the same. Mm-hmm. The men use the same techniques. They tell you it's our secret. They're good to you. You think they're good to you. They give you presents. They make you feel that, oh, they love you. And when you're little, you
yeah,
want that.
You don't, yeah. You don't know that it's wrong.
Well, you don't, you know that it's something that is not normal. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you don't understand. It's now that I think, how could I put up with it? How, you don't understand. It's something that is so, so hard to understand. And that's why any little girl that is molested now, tell the teacher, tell the mother. If the mother doesn't believe, tell the grandma. Tell anybody, but tell, because it's the only way we're going to stop these men.
Most definitely. And now let's hear from Senora Esparza's two amazing daughters, Monica and Anne Marie.
Our mother is incredible, and Anne Marie and I are both so blessed. I mean, the three of us are best friends. And looking back at our childhood, it was the best. I mean, my mom, every night we had, before I went to bed, she'd come in my room and we would talk. And, you know, as I got older, there wasn't one thing I couldn't tell her. And if I had one wish, and now that I'm a mom, don't miss out on that opportunity with your daughters. I could come home many times, tell her something I did do, but I knew she had my back. And that is the best feeling in the world. And I tell my husband constantly, if I could put my mom in a jar and just multiply her formula of being a mom and know that we had an amazing childhood. And it was really hard after I had my little girl to hear her story. It really cut deep, because it was someone that I just think the world of that was so hurt. So it was really hard.
My mom mentioned how she was afraid of the way we would react to her story as her daughters. And I'll never forget when she started to tell us what had happened to her. And I thought, my goodness, I hugged her and I said, you are the most powerful woman I know. She's self-taught. She's driven. If anybody has her eye on the prize and achieves it, it is our mother. There isn't a thing in life that she hasn't looked at, thought of, and achieved. And I told her, we are the product of that strength, that inner strength, that as tragic as your childhood was, losing one parent is tragic, losing two is unimaginable. And then you add molestation on top of that, most people will never have to feel that. But she underwent that and came out a survivor and gave us the tools for us to be powerful women. I remember her saying, if you want to be the president of this great country, you can do it. The only thing standing in your way is you. And that is the power that we grew up with.
Now you see why that interview was so important, why it was the highlight of 2011. Because this is what this show is all about. In one interview, we revealed a pain, we led the family to solutions with Dr. Gilda, and we enlightened an audience and hopefully saved someone from going through the very same thing. I hope you've enjoyed the look back at 2011. It will be my honor to be with you in 2012 and help you explore new ideas, new thoughts, new ways to live, new ways to feel better, ways to get over some old things in our lives, ways to look at the past and finally leave it there, and look ahead to the future and plan for what's ahead. I'm Josefa Salinas. Until we get together again, stay strong, stay focused, and most of all, stay informed. I'll see you next Sunday on the Community Review, Hot 92.3. Gladys Knight's going to take us out of here with one of my favorites that always puts the perfect end to every single year. Enjoy.
Hey, you know, everybody's talking about the good old days, right? Everybody, the good old days, the good old days. Well, let's talk about the good old days. Come to think of it, as bad as we think they are, these will become the good old days for our children. But why don't we try to remember that kind of September when life was slow and oh, so mellow. Try to remember. And if you remember, then follow. Oh, why does it seem that the past is always better? We look back and we think the winters were warmer, the grass was greener, the skies were bluer, and smiles were. Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? And if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we? Memories light the corners of my mind. Misty watercolor memories of the way we were. Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Time rewritten every line, and if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? What's too painful to remember? We
simply choose to forget. So with the laughter, we will remember. Whenever we remember the way. Remember.